So I can actually see several people's presence, which is great, which meaning you've got federation. So we're just going to cover off in a bit of order about Lync Online and Exchange Online with the federation specifically. A topic of mine that's been quite exciting for me for probably about 7 years since I first installed Live Communication Server 2005 and federated with Microsoft. What that really allowed me to do was to see people outside of my organization and communicate with them. So before I go into it, firstly, a little bit about me. In case you haven't picked the accent, I'm Australian. I, as Josh mentioned, Paradigm is my day-to-day company. I also recently started up Extranet, which is effectively creating solutions to, I suppose, improve the user experience of Office 365. One of the solutions, well, the first solution we've actually got to market is actually a Lync contact migrator, which allows you to move contacts between Lync accounts quite easily. I was awarded Office 365 MVP in April of 2011. Before that was a Microsoft Community Contributor Award recipient. I'm very, very passionate about human productivity. This stems from a personal grievance with people hating computers, hating IT, or just coming in and doing their basic job and not really thinking outside of the box and how they can interact more and do more with each other. So part of that is the life on the bleeding edge. I absolutely love playing with new technology. So as soon as there's a beta of anything available, I'll play with it, figure it out, and move on to the next one. So Office 365 was one of those things that I really enjoyed playing with, getting our customers on board, and also helping businesses get more out of it. Now, one of those things for me is federation, as I said before, and you know, breaking down the doors of, breaking down the walls between each organization. So instead of us sitting in our own corporate worlds, siloed from each other, actually being able to see somebody else, like a business partner that we might be dealing with, be they a client, supplier, and actually being able to talk to them. Now, Lync Federation is not exactly a new concept, as I said. It was back in Live Communication Server 2005. But Exchange Federation is something that's relatively new and something that a lot of people don't realize how easy it is to do. So I'm just kind of going to go through the agenda, which is give a bit of background about Federation. Talk about it in Lync Online, then go through what's required for getting Federation working with Exchange Online, and then I'll take you through an actual demonstration. I have sacrificed a black sheep this morning. By the way, it's morning for me in Australia, so hopefully this works fine. So before I jump into it, what I just wanted to quickly find out was, if I get the right one, so who's actually used Federation with Lync before? If I can get, I suppose, a digital show of hands. Okay, I've got a few no's. There's still a few more people to respond. Okay. Interesting. So there's quite a few people that have actually never federated. So this will be, I suppose, a bit of an eye-opening experience. And you'll also see how easy it is to actually do. So just to give you, if I just go back to the presentation, there we go. So what is federation? The Wikipedia definition, if you really want to read that. From my perspective, federation is I can see you, you can see me, we can talk. That's it in a nutshell. If you really want to go into that gigantic text there, realistically, it's a way for different technologies to work together, different environments to work together, so kind of building a bridge between each other. By way of, I suppose, digital hands again, those who did respond that they have used Federation before, can you please let me know, you know, how many contacts you've actually got, how many federated contacts you have in your contact list? Okay. Now, I suppose to give you a bit of context and going further on how much I love Federation, I fall into the bottom category, which is almost every single person on my contact list, which is well over 200, is a federated contact. That's because I federate with our customers, I federate with Microsoft, I federate with Telstra, who's our syndication partner down here, my competitors, my friends at different companies. To me, it's just a way to be able to communicate with people at the drop of a hat and save on having to send emails, leave voicemails, and just communicate at the speed of business. So, just going again back to the presentation. Now, effectively, if we were running Federation on-premise, there's two ports that we would have to allow from our through our firewalls, which is for Lync port 5061, TCP, and for Exchange 443, which is the SSL port or HTTPS. Those are the two ports required to get Federation working. So if, for example, you were federating with an organization that was using Lync on-premise, so Lync Server 2010, or Exchange Server 2010, effectively these are the only ports that they would need to open in order for you to federate with them. There's a few steps they would need to go through to be able to federate with Lync Online and Exchange Online, but we're not going to jump into that. Today we're going to be mainly covering federating with other people in Lync Online and Exchange Online. So I'll go through Lync Online because it is the easiest and simplest to get federation going. So hopefully for those of you who said that they didn't know or they haven't used Federation before, hopefully from this you'll be multitasking and sitting in another window turning it on. So the key process to get Federation working, apart from switching it on, is setting up the SRV record in DNS. So under the Office 365 DNS control panel, it actually shows you what the record is that's required. And it's just that one SRV record, so hopefully your DNS provider can actually provide you with SRV records. If they can't, I suggest you move your domain to a DNS provider that can, otherwise you'll never be able to federate. Effectively, that's it. As you can see, that's our paradigm record. I've just done an NS lookup there to see what the record is that you need to create. And what that allows I suppose the world to do is when they look at paradigm.com.au and somebody adds me to their contact list, it quickly looks up the SRV record in DNS, says where is Loryan, where is his federation, or in traditional Lync server terms, edge server, and starts talking to that. Now in Office 365 it works straight away, which is fantastic. So in Lync Online control panel, to get Lync Online Federation working, you just turn it on. It's a binary switch, you turn it on or leave it off. To walk you through this relatively simple screenshot here, you can either have it blocking everybody except the domains that you allow, or you can simply allow everybody and block the domains that you choose not to federate with. One of the things I haven't covered here is federation with networks like MSN, because again, that's just an enable or disable. Now, turning on federation is fantastic, but what do you do that once you've actually federated? Now, you can randomly try and add connections and see if you can find people. You can have a guess at people's what's called SIP URI, which is Universal Resource Indicator, identifier. Usually someone's SIP URI or SIP address will be the same as their email address. So in my case, my email address is lstrant@paradigm.com.au and my SIP URI is lstrant@paradigm.com.au. What that allows to occur is that when, let's say, Josh receives an email from me, because my SIP address is the same as my email address, when the Lync client actually looks for presence based on my email address in Outlook, it will actually be able to match the two up and say you are present. One of the things, for example, I see in dealing with Microsoft is I'm federated with many, many contacts in Microsoft, but some people will have a different email address from their Lync address, And as such, I don't necessarily always see their presence show up in Outlook, which is quite frustrating, but I just have to revert back to my Lync contact list. So, yeah, we've got Lync. How do we actually now find people to federate with? As I said, you can have a stab in the dark, or you can use this free tool, which was created by a Lync MVP, Matt Landis, which is called the Who Can Federate tool. As you can see there, what it does is it will scan your Outlook contact list. It will look up their domain in the Lync Federation directory, as well as query their SRV records, and it will tell you whether you can actually federate with these people. Now, it shows up the presence orb there. Just because it's green there doesn't mean those people are actually available. It just says, yes, we can federate with them. Effectively, all you do from this tool is just double-click, and you can start conversing with people straight away. So are there any questions so far with Lync before I move on to Exchange? Because that was pretty much it for Lync. Feel free to just IM the messages and I'll respond. Otherwise, I'll continue on our merry journey. We have a question coming. And actually, at any stage along the way, if you do have any questions, just feel free to IM them and I can stop and answer as we go along. Good question, James. The first point, if you haven't actually got Lync up and running, is to go to the portal of Office 365, so portal.microsoftonline.com, and click on the downloads section, and that will actually allow you to download and install Lync for your organization. Then once you've installed it, you can then just start adding contacts, and yeah, then you can go through this federation process. Happy to give you a bit more information there, James, or alternatively, if you go to onlinehelp.microsoft.com, you'll see quite an amazing amount of help documentation and information that actually covers off some of these topics, as well as getting Lync going for your organisation. So I'll move on to Exchange, which is still somewhat as similar to Lync, but does have a few extra steps along the way. So before we can actually establish federation with other Office 365 customers or tenants, one of the things that is important to know is that by default, federation between Office 365 customers is actually allowed. There's simply no relationship, and that's what is our job, is to create that relationship between the other organization. To effectively say that I trust you, the other person says you trust me, and we can begin federating. So by way of digital hands again, another question to ask people, actually firstly, is how many of you knew that Exchange Online could actually federate with other Exchange Online tenants? Okay, a bit of a mix there, almost 50-50. So before going to the next step, how comfortable is everybody with running PowerShell? Because that's a requirement. Great. I hope the people who have answered what's a GUI are identifying the sarcastic intention and are actually asking what a GUI is. Right, so what I'll do, still got a few more answers. Okay, so what we're going to do is, I'm just going to show you through the different steps required for the federation, and then I'll actually perform a live demonstration. So the first one is to actually establish a remote PowerShell connection. So again, I haven't documented the steps here, but I can actually point you to an article I've written previously which does take you through all the steps. Then once we've actually established that PowerShell connection to Exchange Online, one of the important steps, this is only a one-time only step, is to actually enable customization of your organization, which allows you to turn certain features on and off. As I said, this is a one-time only step, so if you have used this commandlet before, you don't need to again, or if you've never used it, then you'll definitely need to use it the first time, but you won't again. So it's a three-step process. So connect to PowerShell, run that command, and then run this command. Now what you're seeing is quite a large amount of text on the screen. So what I was going to do is just break it down a little bit further and actually go through what each of the steps are so you're not just reading gibberish. So the two commandlets that we actually have to run is to obtain the federation information of the other organization. Now, what I've typed in there is otherdomain.com, so ideally you would be using the SMTP domain or email address of the other tenant. So in our case, for example, you would type in getfederationinformation-domainname, then paradigm.com.au. Then we pipe that, so as you saw in the previous, there's a pipe in between this and the next command, which is to create the organizational relationship between the two. So effectively saying, I trust you, you trust me, let's be friends and share calendars. And specify a friendly name for you to remember. So you can type in their company name, you can say my mate's company, if you like. It can be whatever you prefer, perhaps a client reference code, whatever it needs to be. That's completely up to you to identify. Then we've got a couple of different switches. So the first one being, do we want to actually enable free busy access between each other? So yes or no. Obviously, if you can turn it on for a set period of time, so for example, a project, you might be working with an organization for 3 months, so you do want to be able to see each other's calendars. You turn on federation, let's say at the end of the project, you want to turn that off, so obviously we'll run this command again and set it to false. Then something that's very, very important is to define what the free busy access level is. Now, when I was doing this initially back in August the first time, I just went with limited details because I didn't think of what that actually meant, and the person on the other end could see all the information that was in my calendar. So if you're establishing a calendar federation relationship for purely being able to schedule meetings, then use the availability only, because that will just show the blue bar in each other's calendars of whether you can, whether you're free or busy. Whereas if you do want more information, you're working closely with other organizations, and you do want them to see the details, you can actually specify that you want limited details, and that will show things like the subject of the meeting as well as the location. Now, something I actually haven't made note of here is that on an individual basis, you can actually turn this off as well. So if you go into your calendar properties or your calendar sharing properties, you can specify that the default permission level is, nobody can see your calendar, and that will actually block it. So, for example, the CEO might not want to participate. So that establishes the relationship. Now, the next step is to rinse and repeat. Do it on both sides for it to actually work. Otherwise, you'll simply have a one-way relationship. If you type in those commands and set up the federation, what that will actually do is allow the remote party to see your calendar, but it won't allow you to see theirs. So you do need to do it on both sides. So what I'm going to do, unless there's any questions at this stage, I'm just going to jump into a demonstration. So I'll just pause for a couple of seconds if there's any questions so far. Okay, no questions. So far, so good. So what I'm just going to do now is share with you a virtual PC I've got running in one of our demonstration tenants. Okay, so first step is to load up PowerShell. Now, you can either use the black box version of it, or you can use the ISE version. I do that because it allows me to take a little bit more time and to choose whether the commands that I run get executed then and there. So first thing I'm going to do is establish that remote PowerShell connection. Save my credentials. Now, has everyone seen this screen at a decent size? Great. So the reason why I prefer to use ISE sometimes is because it allows me to put in multiple commands before I actually execute them, so I can just execute them sequentially, plus also I get to see if the commandlet is still running or not. So I'm just still in the process of establishing this remote PowerShell connection and importing the commandlets that I've got available to me. Thanks, Mark. So now I'm effectively going to establish a relationship to Paradigm from my demonstration tenant. So what this is doing is, as I said, the first part of the command is it's actually pulling the information about that tenant down. Mark, that's very distracting, you posting comments on Facebook while I'm doing this. And it's pulled down the information about the tenant and now actually applied the ability for paradigm.com.au, so using my production account, to look at the free busy of my tenant. Now, what I'm actually going to do, and again, hoping that the demo gods don't fail me here, is I should actually be able to see the free busy of somebody else. So the federation can take some time to establish, so let me just reshare that screen. So effectively, what I'll just do is I'll show you that again, but the account that I'm actually in is lpdemo@office365p.com.au, a completely separate tenant, and all I've had to do here is click on New Meeting, typed in my lstrant@paradigm.com.au, and if I have a look then at Scheduling Assistant, so it just takes a couple of moments because it's actually going to contact the server. So here we go. As you can see here, I told you it was morning for me. You can see here that I've actually got something booked in. So starting from 10 a.m., the next available meeting time will actually be free. And there I'm out of the office. So it'll still show that whether I'm busy or out of the office. It'll still show whether I'm tentative. And that's as simple as it takes. Excuse me. The other way, it can also work the other way, is I'll just share another screen with you, is where I've actually shared more information than just that. And again, just waiting for Federation to update, so I'm just going to share another screen with you. So because I've established a two-way relationship between between both paradigm.com.au and office365p.com.au, you can actually see there's my calendar and there's the calendar of lpdemo@office365p.com.au. That's all my stuff. Then let me have a look for more things in his calendar. There we go. Okay, looks like in that one all I've got is a team meeting on Friday that's showing up. So any questions on this? Good question, Josh. Any other reasons to federate other than seeing free busy? From an exchange perspective, not really. That's the prime reason. One of the things that I suppose from a why it is so advantageous to do this in the first place is that instead of sending messages between each other repeatedly saying, are you free Thursday? What about Friday? What about 10:30? Okay, what about 11? How about 3? All right, the next week after. You can simply just get to the chase and simply just send a meeting request because you can see when they're available. Apart from that, not really, but in Lync Federation, obviously we want to see it from a lot more reasons than just free busy. Was there anybody who actually wanted to see a demonstration of enabling federation in Lync Online for those that haven't actually done it yet? Sure thing, James. Bear with me because I can't use the tag. Here's one I prepared earlier. So hopefully you can all see my Internet Explorer screen now. So effectively, for James and anybody else, once you're in the control panel, just click on Lync Online and click on the Manage, which will take you to the new version of the interface. So once in here, all we do is click on External Communications. And here's where we enable federation. So click on Edit. And that's it, turn it on or off. Quite binary in that aspect. One of the features I'll probably go off on a slight tangent, which I blogged about last night, or last night for me, probably morning for you, well, for most of you, is this new section here, which is presence and notification, and the ability to restrict your presence information from being displayed to other people on Office 365 or Lync Online, because by default we are all allowed federation with each other. So right now I can see the presence of several of you who are actually in this session, even though I've never, you know, worked with you before. So this actually allows me to say that nobody can see my presence unless I actually add them to my contact list. So, any further questions? So James, on the front page of your, once you log into the Office 365 portal, you'll see Lync Online and Manage. Once you click on that, that will take you to the Lync Online control panel. So, any further questions?
Yeah, that was great. Thank you so much. Be sure I dropped in some information into this chat box, but be sure to ask Loryan any additional questions. Read his blog, follow him on Twitter, check out Paradigm. But we'll hang on just for a few minutes for any additional questions. And, if you have any final words or anything else.
Look, I think it is quite important for people to federate with each other. You've really got to use this, whether it's the Exchange or the Lync or both. As I said, I'm quite a big fan of this and I've been using it for many years because it really does speed up your day-to-day operations. You can talk to people a lot faster. You can see when they're online. You can respond to them via instant message instead of replying via email, leaving a message. And again, with the Exchange calendar, you can just schedule a meeting as opposed to having to send emails back and forward or call each other and see when you're available before scheduling it. So federation really does increase the speed of business, and I really can't say how much I'm a fan.
Yeah, I definitely agree. It definitely comes in handy. So great. Well, thanks again, and I'll stop the recording session now, but if you have any additional questions, feel free to reach out to us now or on the community, and this is both of our community information. Just send us a private message. And, thank you so much. Great presentation.